Now let's move to the next overhead. No, the next one after that. Okay, this is the B section, the second thematic material of the early symphony. Once again, it's relatively devoid of ambiguities. Although it does, by the way, contain a theme which later on turns up in Mozart's, in the Mass that we're doing. This right there. But it's difficult for the mind to define any clear thought object corresponding to the transformation from the first set of ambiguities to the next. Now, and to the next one, please. This is C, and this is the third idea, and it's a jolly little melody. It almost makes you forget what happened at the beginning, in a trivial way, it seems more of a diversion, bringing us away from a unified thought, higher thought object corresponding to the entire movement, and the movement proceeds throughout later on. In the parts that we haven't played, through various modified statements of A, B, and C, which alternate with each other, but they really don't work with each other polyphonically at all. They're relatively hermetically separated from each other. Now, let's hear the entire opening section from the Haydn's later post-breakthrough symphony number 78. Thank you. quite a difference. Now, the next overhead. This is the B section. It already uses makes great use of the F sharp to divide the first four measures into two parts. Da 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 da. This F sharp, F D da da. This immediately opens up the potential for a two-voiced canonical presentation, where you see da di da 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 di da da. So they're weaving in and out with each other in two voices, with the first violins and the first oboe in canon, with the second violins, violas, and second oboe. C, now let's go to the next one. Then goes even further and presents a rhythmic dissonance by virtue of its very brevity. This is something that Haydn invented, taking very, very small snippets, which you wouldn't even think of as being important, three or four notes, and developing these, and this is bum 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 bottom, bum 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 bottom, bum 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 bottom. Right? Now you can almost experience the excitement of the young Beethoven as he studied this work, and he planted the seeds which later flowered into Beethoven's third symphony in E flat major and his fifth symphony in C minor. Just recall, if you remember the E flat one, the Eroica symphony, it has a little theme, which is identical here, and also in the fifth symphony. In short, we have a sequence now of statements in the succession in this later symphony, which is potentially very rich in thought objects, which Haydn begins to exploit in the movement's subsequent development. And I just want to play one very, very brief example in which you have a double canon of the A section with its own inversion, and it works with C, the third idea, to create an entirely new kind of cross voice. It's just a little snippet. I just play that. Evident, but you hear a cross voice right there, right, which is going across the instruments. It's a kind of new voice. Now, this all sets the stage for the third component of Mozart's revolution, namely the revolution which went on inside Mozart's own head as he studied side by side his close friend Haydn's new scores, along with the collection of J.S. Bach's scores, which Van Swieten had made available to Mozart in connection with the small gatherings which Van Swieten was holding every Sunday at noon, beginning in 1782. In a series of works, some complete and some not so, in many cases directly utilizing the royal theme in the key of C minor, Mozart combined the Bach and Haydn breakthroughs to the effect of forging a new revolution, a medium of classical polyphony, which exists as one of our most powerful weapons in the battle for the ennoblement of the human individual. Mere description of this revolution inside Mozart's head fails to convey its full significance. And so, in a few minutes, we're going to perform excerpts from the incomplete 1783 Mass in C minor, which he wrote for his as a wedding gift for his future bride, in a way, and performing it in a way which I hope will allow you to begin reconstructing that revolution within your own minds as you listen, think, and judge. But before we do this, I want to briefly identify each of the major elements which flow from the thought object of this piece, and also point out some crucial transitional passages to listen for, since it's in such transitional passages which link the particular motives that we often find the clearest demonstration of the Motivführung principle in action. Okay, can I have the next figure? You earlier heard the opening material of the Mass that's shown here. This is... right there. And with the first violins highlighting the C minor with the register shift, which I show there. So, mi, mi, mi. With the basses singing their line, with the descending from C down to A in half steps, and then with the jump from A to G. I'm a tenor, so that's hard for me to do. But also note the maximum point of dissonance, which is there is the inclusion of a D flat. I don't know if this can be pointed to. It's in measure three. There you go. Right. Which heightens the introduction of the F sharp, and which at which point you have the F sharp being played against a C in the second violins, a G in the violas, and a B flat in the basses. It's a highly dissonant. It's the point of maximum stress of the entire piece. When the piece opens, try to listen for this. When the piece opens, it seems very conventional when it starts, but then all of a sudden, by this third measure, you say, "Wow, something else is going on here." This is what Mozart introduced. Now, this is immediately followed. Can I have the next overhead? These are just the elements of the Kyrie. By the chorus's first entrance on the word Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy on us, powerfully asserting the C minor component of Frederick the Great's challenge to old Bach. The sopranos and tenors are taken through all three vocal registers. You can see from the red to the yellow to the blue and back down. Right. And the two female voices and the two male voices are paired. That is, they change register at the same place because of the nature of the leaps involved. And the ascent is followed by a descent, which is this ascending-descending idea, which is also part of the music, the Bach royal theme material. Now, can I have the next figure? The full orchestra then asserts itself, with also a beat of, on the timpani drum here, with the violins taking up their original line. While the sopranos sing what appears to be an entirely new line. But actually, this is but an altered form of the original descending bass line. That is, the alteration is that superimposed on this half-stepwise descent are some leaps, which if we emphasize them by making the notes bigger, look as following. And can I have the next one here? The top one is Kyrie, or Kyrie eleison. At the top, that's Mozart's alteration. Well, at the bottom is the opening theme of a different section of the Mass, the final fugue section, which we're going to perform tonight, which is Cum Sancto Spiritu. And notice, if you turn the top figure upside down, invert it, so to speak, you get pretty much the bottom figure. And J.S. Bach would have definitely nodded in approval at the young Mozart's approach here to integrating the entirety of this Mass. The opening section of the Kyrie is divided into three sections: Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, with the Christe section being sung by an individual solo soprano, as is fitting for the text, with its greater focus on the role of the individual acting in the imitation of Christ. But this section is very much a Platonic trialogue with both the chorus and the orchestra, an interaction, and the soloist, an interaction which becomes most intense during the transition back to the full choral Kyrie at the end. It's also the first place in the Mass which uses octave transpositions. You'll hear it in the theme. Eleison, eleison. That you'll hear the, if you listen, you'll hear the octave, the violins coming in at an octave higher. Now, the following movement that we'll do is the Gloria, to the words Gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra pax hominibus bone voluntatis, which means glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of goodwill. It's a variation on the material presented in the Kyrie section, and I'll leave you to listen for this. It also shows signs of another composer, by the way, who was introduced and studied by this same von Swieten circle, George Frederick Handel. Compare, for instance, Mozart's In Excelsis, well, you're going to hear In Excelsis, In Excelsis, In Excelsis, to the very famous piece from Handel's Messiah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And you'll see the influence. After that, we're going to skip a number of sections, not sing them, that is, and proceed to the monumental double choral section, set to the words, Qui tollis peccata mundi miserere nobis, qui tollis peccata mundi suscipe deprecationem nostram, qui sedes ad dextram patris miserere nobis, which means, thou who bearest or taketh away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Thou who takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou who sittest at the right hand of God, of the Father, have mercy on us. This is also a direct variation on the descending bass line in the opening Kyrie. May I have the next figure?
Qui tollis peccata mundi.
It's that same descending figure there. Okay, we're then going to skip in our performance again to the brief setting of Jesu Christe, which is actually the last words of the phrase, Tu solus altissimus Jesu Christe, thou alone art most high, Jesus Christ. Mozart's poetic intent in separating out the Jesu Christe as a separate movement is related to his poetic intent of providing an appropriate fanfare for the great double fugue which follows and which will conclude our performance. I already pointed out the genesis of this theme.
Cum Sancto Spiritu.
The words of the fugue, which also conclude the entire Gloria sequence of the Mass, are Cum Sancto Spiritu in Gloria Dei Patris, Amen, together with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God, the Father, Amen. Now to conclude, I want to point out a special feature of this fugue, which you should listen for, a place in which all of the voices of the orchestra and the chorus combine to create a new voice which runs very obviously across all of the voices. Can I have the next figure? As you can see, it's running notes. I'll just sing a little bit of it. I'm not going to make the chorus sing it alone. But it's right in the center of the fugue, and it just go. It starts with the tenors, and the tenors go. And then the altos come in, and you'll hear that this will be going through all different voices. First the tenors, the altos, then the sopranos, and then the basses come in. And then it even moves into the strings and goes all the way from the bottom of the violas playing, and then all the way up through all the registers of the violins. It is, however, very difficult for this to be performed with transparency, and I hope you'll be able to hear it. I'd like to now hand over the podium to Mozart, and I thank you for your attention.